we start with, what did Darwin mean by the function of the heart? So were we to ask him, he would say, the function of Gordon's heart is to pump blood. And then I'm a doctor and I say, but Mr. Darwin, Gordon's heart makes heart sounds and it wiggles water in his pericardial sac. And Darwin would say, yeah, but that's not the function of Gordon's heart. The function of his heart is to pump blood. And if I said, well, why do you say that? He would say, because it was selected and exists in the universe to pump blood. Now that's already interesting because it says that the function of the heart, a biological term, not a physicist term in which only happenings occur, there are no functions except mathematical functions, but no functionality in physics, that the functionality of the heart to pump blood is a subset of its causal consequences. And that already means that if Steven Weinberg could deduce at this time moment, synchronically, not across time, diachronically, all of the properties of Gordon's heart from the quarks and the gluons in his heart, he'd have no way of picking up pumping blood as being particularly important. And why it is that the heart came to exist in the universe, okay, to do that he either has to become a biologist or he has to simulate the evolution of the universe, which I think is impossible because there's infinitely many flips of the quantum dice, or very many. And how would we ever confirm that he got the right quantum history? And now I'm about to argue that he can't deduce the evolution of the biosphere. So that's the next step about these Darwinian pre-adaptations. So Darwin, pre-adaptation does not mean foresight. It's just a term that's gotten used. And Stephen Gould, the great paleontologist here at Harvard, called them exaptations to avoid the implications of design. So I'll use Steve's phrase of an exaptation. So Darwin's idea was, look, there could be a property of an organ of no selective use whatsoever in the current environment that might turn out to be useful in a different environment. So I'll give just two cases, and I know you both know them, but we're also talking for an audience. The first one is a swim bladder. So there are fish with swim bladders, partially filled with air, partially filled with water. And the level of water in the swim bladder adjusts neutral buoyancy in the water column. Paleontologists think that swim bladders arose from lungfish. Water got into the lungs of some lungfish. The lungfish now has this sac so filled, and it's poised to become a swim bladder. So that's a Darwinian exaptation. Two questions, and I'll get to the critical third question. First, I know we all agree, but let's just say it. Did a new function come to exist in the biosphere, neutral buoyancy in the water column? Well, we all agree, right? Of course it did. Did it affect the future evolution of the biosphere? Of course it did, new species and new proteins. So it affected the becoming of the universe, or at least our little corner of it. Now I'm going to come to a second example before I get to my main third question. As you know, you have three middle ear bones, incus, malleus, and stapes. And they evolved from three adjacent jawbones in an early fish by Darwinian pre-adaptations or exaptations. And the reason that's important is that spatial relationships matter to this process of exaptation. Had one been in the skull, one in the spine, and one in the jaw, we wouldn't have gotten, almost certainly, the three ear bones. Once again, did a new function, hearing, come to exist? Sure. Did it affect the becoming of the biosphere? Sure. Now I'm going to come to my critical question, and I know, again, you both know it, but for the people who are watching us, could you say ahead of time all possible Darwinian pre-adaptations for all organisms alive now? And then you object, I don't know all organisms alive now. And I say, right. Can you say ahead of time all possible pre-adaptations or exceptions just for humans? Let's pause. Can you say it just for humans, all pre-adaptations? And I've now asked thousands of people, and again, we both know, we all agree that the answer is no, we cannot say it. So let's pause. We can't say it. We do not know. And here's part of the reason why I think we can't. How would we list all possible selective environments? How would we even start on the list? But how would we know we'd completed it? How would we say ahead of time all possible features of organisms might turn out to be pre-adaptations? How would we get started on it?